another playoff edition of NHL Tonight with Brian Lawton. I'm Jamie Hirsch. Wow, we have finally reached the end of the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. 5-7, second most in any series in Stanley Cup playoff history. And the Penguins and Rangers coming down to overtime to be decided. It's the home team, the New York Rangers, with the overtime win. An incredible game. And Lots, the first team in Stanley Cup playoff history to have three straight comeback wins in elimination games in the same series. Resilience doesn't even sum it all up.
Well, they definitely weren't soft, as may have been mentioned earlier in the series. But guess what? Three come from behind victories to rip off three wins in a row. Oof. They were dynamic. And why not? That's what it should be in Madison Square Garden. Drama.
Yes. Chris Kreider, after game six, expecting it to be Madison Square Jungle, not a garden. It was just that and more. Let's get to the full highlights from Madison Square Garden. Tristan Jarry and Sidney Crosby back in the lineup. The Rangers, by the way, 7-1 all time in game sevens at Madison Square Garden, entering this one. Early in the first, the Penguins have it in the zone. Couple of great chances here early for Pittsburgh, but Igor Shesterkin stops both.
Shesterkin making a statement early that he'll be locked in. He wasn't off balance at all. He was terrific in this game.
A few seconds after that, Rangers on the rush. It's Mika Zibanejad over to Chris Kreider, and he scores. The place goes wild.
Kreider picks up his fifth right here. Watch him take his time as that puck comes kind of slowly from Zibanejad. But that's okay, because he picks his spot, and he hits it perfectly, bar down. Kreider with his fifth of the year.
Late in the period, the Penguins on a power play here. Jeff Carter puts one on net. It appears to cross the goal line. The initial call is no goal, but after further review, that was deemed a good goal off the stick of Danton Heinen.
Mike Sullivan knew it. He recognized it. Probably got a call from his video coach that, hey, that went across the goal line. I don't know why Ricard Raquel wasn't celebrating more. He was right there. He must have seen it. Doesn't matter. It counted.
Midway through the second now, Penguins on a power play. Brian Rust over to Jake Guentzel. We got to take a few looks at this one because I think this is one of the most impressive goals we've seen this playoffs.
It really was. Jake Guentzel right there is waiting for that puck to drop just a bit before he knocks it down with the heel of his stick. The toe clearly above the crossbar, toe of the blade that is, but no. He gets it with the heel, and that's what matters. Check it out, folks. Rule 80.3 in the rule book. That's a good goal.
Yeah, the point of contact below the crossbar, at or below. So here we go. Pens on a power play, and Shesterkin makes two great saves here to keep them off the board.
He really does. This first one is terrific on Erod. He stays with it, tracks it down, and look at Shesterkin. The diving effort to keep it out of the back of the net.
Less than a minute later, Keandre Miller shoots. It deflects in off Mike Matheson's skate, and we're tied at two.
Looked like it might have been a double, Karen, for Keandre Miller. As right there, it changes direction. Then again, off of Matheson's skate, and Jarry just can't get it.
Under three to go in the period. New York on a power play. The Rangers turn it over. Evan Rodriguez in all alone. Scores on the backhand, and the Penguins take the lead.
A little short-handed attempt right here. That's going to be a goal because that's a beautiful backhand by Erod. Keandre Miller just doesn't want to take a penalty in the back of the net, and Erod has his third of the series unassisted.
Penguins on the power play here. Nice pass brings Tyler Mott on a breakaway, but Jarry ends up coming up big.
The late-season acquisition, Tyler Mott. He was good in this game, brought a lot of energy to the Rangers.
And you see the look on the bench. Oh, so close. Under six to play. Penguins with a turnover. The pass finds Mika Zibanejad. He shoots and scores to tie it.
Makes no mistake. Had a big game last game. Well, he's on his way to having another big one again right here as he buries this one. Second point of the game. I love it. Right over the shoulder, right next to the ear, buzzes the tower.
It's a beauty. The place goes wild. We go to overtime. Keandre Miller with a semi-breakaway. He's going to get hooked. A penalty.
My goodness. Could that be a penalty shot? No. It's just a holding penalty, but that's okay.
Ensuing power play. Puck comes to Artemi Panarin, and he makes his presence felt in a huge way. Brings the place to life. It's the OTGWG for the Breadman.
The Breadman, he played well in this series, but he hadn't had any real huge moments. He was at a point a game, But now he gets the OT winner in game seven, shoots it through a crowd as the power play was winding down. And he showed up in a big way, as did that man right there. He was terrific. And Panarin, he's got some leap in his game.
He does. We've seen the leg kick. Now he's got the jump, too. Either way, you know the party is on for the New York Rangers. They win a huge game to advance to the second round, where they will face the Carolina Hurricanes. After the game, Mika Zibanejad spoke with Jackie Redmond.
The game-tying goal to send this thing to overtime. Biggest goal of your life?
Probably, yeah. We kept saying, just put the puck to the net, try to get going. We didn't have much to save for, so it was nice to see it go in.
Pucks on net, good things happen. This team has faced so much resiliency in this series. You lose triple overtime in game one. You close it out in overtime. What does that say about the character of this team?
I think it's been there all year. We believe in the group that we have in there. I said it before, it feels like a family. Everyone wants to see the next guy right next to you succeed, and everyone's working for each other. And it's a slogan, but it's been kind of our mantra with the no quit in New York, and that's what we showed all year.
There was certainly no quit from you guys in this series, battling back from 3-1. I know you're a music guy. What are you blaring in the room after such a huge W?
I don't know. I don't pick the music anymore, so I'll just enjoy whatever they put on.
Who's the new DJ?
We got a couple of guys.
All right, good. Congratulations and thank you for this.
Take a look at how historic this comeback win was. Comeback series win for the New York Rangers. Only the third time in Original Six franchise history that they've been able to overcome a 3-1 series deficit. And this one just feels so...
Yes, you know, that's why he's such a good coach, right? Maybe he just struck the right tone with players that motivated them to show up in games 5, 6, 7 with wins.
Yeah, he really does. In my opinion, Gallant's got really good bedside manners, to say. He just handles his team beautifully. He lets them know what he wants from them. But it's not in the old school way where you're really trying to kind of intimidate players. He just calls it how he sees it. He's very direct. He's very straightforward, and he's very honest. And the Rangers respond to that. That was clear. And it kind of makes sense. They've got some veterans that know what they need to do, and they've got some younger players that could easily lose their confidence and go the other way. So I love the job he did. I love the job this team did. I love the job that man right there. Give him in game 7. They needed him a big way or they would not get this done. And then on the other side, of course, you see the leadership skills of C. Crosby right there. It's no fun to lose, but you can still handle it with grace, as he always had. He's had his share of winning moments.
Yeah, certainly has. The series ended up feeling more like 2 months rather than 2 weeks. We go all the way back to game one. Remember, that was the triple overtime game that Pittsburgh actually won at Madison Square Garden. I go back to even the regulation in that game. The Rangers thought they had won that game.
He's very direct. He's very straightforward, and he's very honest. And the Rangers respond to that. That was clear. And it kind of makes sense. They've got some veterans that know what they need to do, and they've got some younger players that could easily lose their confidence and go the other way. So I love the job he did. I love the job this team did. I love the job that man right there gave them in game 7. They needed him in a big way or they would not get this done. And then on the other side, of course, you see the leadership skills of Sidney Crosby right there. It's no fun to lose, but you can still handle it with grace, as he always had. He's had his share of winning moments.
Yeah,
too.
Certainly has. This series ended up feeling more like 2 months rather than 2 weeks, too. And then again, 3 straight elimination game victories for the New York Rangers. But Igor Shesterkin certainly has been the difference when it mattered most in this series. Going back to that triple overtime winner, 79 saves, and here again 42 in game 7. How do you sum up just what he means and the demeanor that he has for this team?
Well, the series win certainly validates the team's performance this year. This game 7, though, this validates Igor Shesterkin as that guy. They should win the Vezina. Already been voted on, by the way, but it definitely puts a stamp on it.
Yeah.
He was the best goalie in the National Hockey League this year. He outperformed everyone. No disrespect to Saros or Markstrom, who had great seasons also, but he was the guy that stood out. If you look at the numbers, the things he did in giving this team time, to find their confidence, giving management time to make some additions at the deadline where they were still in things. And then the way that he led them night in and night out, spoke often about, didn't always understand everything. He just knew when they called his name, it was time to get it going. And boy, did he get it going tonight in this one in a big way. He was the star of the show for me, with Zibanejad right behind him.
Yes.
Two goals and an assist in this one. He played terrific. Fox was great. And then Panarin, he finally kind of broke out.
Right.
There was a huge story here in New York that it was time for Panarin to enter this series. Well, he did have a point of game, so I wouldn't say he wasn't in it. But he hadn't really had a big moment. Well, he found it tonight in overtime.
Yes, I think we'll have the high leg kick, the Rockettes thing. That was such his MO for so long. He certainly showed up in the biggest moment so far. Game 7, OT, GWG. Let's get some more post-game reaction from Madison Square Garden.
No, it's great. It's great experience for our young players. You know, we talk about it all the time. I mean, before the series started, I'm sure a lot of people said there's not much experience with this group and you look at the other side, they get all that experience. And for me, it's about guys playing the right way. They got a lot of experience during the season, and, you know, it showed in that series. I thought the kids played pretty good hockey overall, and I thought our team played pretty strong.
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge win for the team, for the organization. Gutsy performance, coming back again. That whole no quit in New York thing is pretty true with this group.
I think it stinks. He has to come off. His helmet got pulled off intentionally. But that's the rule.
It's disappointing. I mean, we're right there. You know, we put ourselves in a good spot, being up 3-1, and then it's just disappointing to think about that we had a lead in each game and kind of give that away. So, I mean, just an amazing group. We believed the whole time and just didn't go our way.
I think you try not to really think about that. You hope that, you know, we make a good run, and it's something in the back of your mind, but it's something that we knew was a possibility heading into the playoffs, but I don't think it's something that I really tried to think about too much, to be honest with you.
Our final game 7 of the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs happening up in Calgary. We've got full highlights and post-game reaction from game 7 between the Stars and Flames coming up next.
And the Dallas Stars do battle for the second time in 3 seasons. There's a shot, score! Wayne Robertson steals it from Pavelski, scores! Shoots and rebounds! Pavelski's got another! What a save by Jacob Markstrom! What a save! And stopped by Markstrom! Bacciapani with Gabranson, score! And the Stars and the Flames are going to game 7.
The 5th of 5 game 7s in round 1. It's the Stars and the Flames, and Calgary trying to get to the second round for the first time since 2015. For the Stars, first line center Roope Hintz was a late scratch, so Dennis Gurianov playing in his place. Less than a minute into the game, the Stars dump it in. Tyler Seguin will chase, feeds Jamie Benn, who makes no mistake, and Dallas, just like that, has the early lead.
Nice pass by Tyler Seguin, and quick release by Jamie Benn. Picks up his first of the series, and the Dallas Stars were off and running 1-0 in the first period.
6 minutes to go. Miro Heiskanen with a shot that's saved by Jacob Markstrom. Joe Pavelski tried the rebound, but Markstrom denied him.
And Markstrom played really well in this series, got a little bit overshadowed by the greatness of Jake Oettinger.
2-on-1 for Calgary. Dylan Dubé shot saved by Oettinger.
Cue the greatness for Oettinger. He makes a huge save right here with the right arm.
We go to the second. First couple minutes of play in the middle frame. Calgary has it. Oliver Shillington's shot from the blue line tipped in by Tyler Toffoli for his first of the series.
And they were going wild outside the building and inside as Shillington just slings this one at Oettinger. And Tyler Toffoli reaches out with the backhand tip, and he's got his first of the series.
Moments later, the Stars come right back on the rush. Jason Robertson to Joe Pavelski. Another pass over to Vladislav Namestnikov, and he scores to make it 2-1.
Great three-way passing play right here. Namestnikov buries it Look at Pavelski. You think he's going to shoot that? No. Slides it over beautifully to Namestnikov, and he's got his first of the series. 2-1 Dallas Stars at this stage.
Power play winding down for Calgary. Check out the Markstrom stretch pass there to Johnny Hockey. He feeds Matthew Tkachuk for a beauty of a shot.
Yeah, this really is. Watch Matthew Tkachuk. He's going to open up the hips, turn, makes himself available, gets a beautiful pass from Goodrow and buries it in the top corner. He's got his first of the series.
Early in the third, Flames with the puck. Shot that's blocked in front. The rebound comes out, and Tkachuk with a shot that's saved by Ottinger.
Yeah, Ottinger was everywhere. Look at this nice push with the right leg. Gets over, snuffs out the second opportunity.
What are those fans doing?
This was just creepy.
Trying to get in the head of Jake Ottinger. Good luck. Jacob Peterson here on a breakaway. Markstrom also looking good in goal.
Big save for Markstrom. Not nearly as busy in this game, but he made all the key saves when he had to.
Stars able to hold here. Dellandrea gets it, passes back to Miro Heiskanen, and his shot rings off the iron.
Dellandrea, late addition to this game, as Roope Hintz was a no-show in terms of an early scratch, late scratch, excuse me.
We go to overtime. Flames on the power play. Ottinger with multiple grade A saves right in the crease. Robs Goodrow with the glove.
Unbelievable save right here by Ottinger on Johnny Goodrow, who looks to the sky, hands on the head. He can't believe it.
Later in OT, the Flames of the turnover. Back come the Stars. Tyler Seguin right in front. Can't get the tip to go.
Oh, he's going to have nightmares about that one right there. Clear 3-on-2. Seguin needs to just direct it into the back of the net, and it shoots off wide.
Flames with another chance here, and by chance I mean multiple chances. Look at Jake Ottinger. Loses his stick. The puck goes all over the place. We're going to continue on. Ottinger still without a stick. Chance after chance, and somehow locks his puck. Stays out.
Incredible. Noah Hanifin starts this melee off. They stay with it, but they cannot get it by Ottinger.
About a minute after that, Goodrow off a rebound here. Snake bitten all night, but not when it mattered most. Johnny Hockey delivers on his 7th shot on goal of the night. Jake Ottinger can't believe it. He did everything for the Stars in this one, but Calgary wins a heartbreaker.
Yes, Ottinger really did. And this is a perfect shot by Johnny Goodrow. Look at how much little room is above the shoulder. It doesn't matter. The goalies exchange something a little less than goalie hugs, but a lot of respect between both of them. This was an incredible hockey.
Incredible. Wow, what a series, and what a way to finish the first round, right? An overtime thriller. Johnny Hockey wins it to send the Flames to the second round, where they will face the Edmonton Oilers. Let's hear from the OT hero after the game.
What does this feel like right now?
This is awesome. It's special. It's a great fan base here. We love playing in front of them. It's great to get a win here in Game 7, and a big round coming up for us.
Take me through overtime and the goal.
Yeah, it's kind of back and forth throughout the whole game and throughout the whole overtime, and found Lindy there, took a shot on that. I grabbed the rebound and got a quick shot off.
John, this team has not advanced to the second round since 2015. Inside that room, you know you all had a very good regular season. Now to advance and set up a Battle of Alberta. I know you got to soak this in for a moment, but I'm sure you're already looking ahead.
Oh, yeah, we're excited. We're going to enjoy this tonight and get back to work tomorrow and get ready for a fun series coming up.
What does a Battle of Alberta mean to this group?
I've been here for 9 years, haven't seen a one, so I'm sure the fans are excited. We're excited. They're excited. It's going to be awesome.
John, congrats.
Yeah, thanks.
Congratulations to Johnny Gaudreau and the Calgary Flames. I thought earlier on Johnny Gaudreau is not going to sleep no matter what happens in this, just because of the number and quality of the chances that he had in this game. But in the end, relief is his. And I mean, I can't be happier for him than we are right now after what he went through in this game.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it was unbelievable. He was the little engine that could and finally got it done.
Finally did.
Time after time, golden opportunities. It was one of those nights where he probably figured this may not be my night.
Right.
I've had so many great golden opportunities to score and haven't been able to get anything by Ottinger. And then finally he breaks through. And of course he hasn't seen a Battle of Alberta. That's because the last one was 2 years before he was born.
In the playoffs, yes.
My goodness. 2 goals, 6 assists, 8 points in this series. Almost 23 minutes tonight. 7 shots on net. He just never gave up. He was relentless. And good for him for finally breaking through. That was a perfect shot. Tough angle, but a perfect shot. You got to feel for Jake Oettinger. He played so darn well in this series.
Oh, absolutely.
Mind just this game. 60 saves.
Mm-hmm. Oh, incredible. Incredible effort and really an incredible series that, you know, in the beginning, remember, the first game was 1-0. Second game, 2-0. I mean, goals came at a premium in this series, and yet here we are. They both opened it up down the stretch, and this was a very exciting game of hockey to watch.
Yeah, it really was. This one was different. Dallas completely turned it on in that middle of that third period. Jake Oettinger, on the other hand, lost two games in which he made 50-plus saves in this series. You can't ask any more of him. He was money. At 23 years old, you have to wonder if he understood the gravity of the moment
right.
on some nights because he looked so unflappable. That one in particular by Gaudreau on the power play was a very dynamic save for Oettinger. He just didn't buckle at all to me. He looked so calm and cool. If not for Gaudreau beating him finally to end the game, I would have said this was almost a perfect game for him.
Oh.
It really, truly was.
Hard to even know what to say if you're his teammate, right? We saw Jamie Benn standing next to him after allowing that goal in overtime, and you just feel for the guy that made, what, the third most saves in a single playoff series in NHL history. I mean, this is just incredible what we witnessed here. And yes, this one did go to overtime, but had it ended in regulation, he would have actually set a new Stanley Cup playoff record for most saves in a game seven in a non-overtime game. Now, that record is kind of a wash now because it did go to overtime. But either way, the future is certainly bright for Dallas in between the pipes. I mean, Jake Oettinger is a bona fide star, and this was his kind of coming of age moment, I think, in hockey.
Yeah, well, when you think about it, I mean, he was really their fourth goaltender to start the season.
Right.
You had Khudobin, you had Ben Bishop, you had Braden Holtby in the mix. Mm-hmm. Eventually, it falls to him, and I just don't think that the Dallas Stars ever imagined they'd get this type of goaltending from Oettinger at this stage in his career. At only 23, generally takes a little longer to get the mental aspect down. Well, I think he's conquered that part of it.
Okay, yes, I would agree. So the matchups are set now that the first round is officially in the books.
Yes.
Overtime on the final night of the first round for both game sevens. But when we look at the Battle of Alberta, you had mentioned this earlier. It's the first playoff meeting for the Battle of Alberta since 1991, before I'd say most of the players on those two teams were even born. So what do you expect in terms of the style of this game and how they'll match up?
I think it's going to be a much more open series, even though Daryl Sutter won't admit that. Whenever these two teams play, the Edmonton Oilers, of course, and the Calgary Flames, it's pretty hard to slow Connor McDavid down. Certainly the way the Dallas Stars were able to slow down the Calgary Flames, and the Calgary Flames are able to slow down the Dallas Stars. So I expect it to be wide open, a lot of excitement. And you can expect the crowd to be three times as wild as it was in this one, which is almost unimaginable.
Yeah, the schedule has just come out. Game one between these two teams, talking about the Oilers and the Flames, of course, will actually be in Calgary on Wednesday night. So that same scene that we just saw here tonight with the crowd outside the building going absolutely bonkers, I'm sure will be even more amped up as they play a second round playoff series starting on Wednesday. Let's hear from the winning head coach, Daryl Sutter, after the game.
But I think, you know, our fans picked us up different parts of the game, gave us energy, so it was awesome. Yeah, we deserved to win. It took 100 and some shots. If we'd lost, I know what you'd have been saying, so we deserved to win. So that's questions and answers. We deserved to win. Simple.
I was kind of just trying to put it on net, to be honest with you. I mean, that kid played pretty well throughout the whole series, so just trying to get pucks in the net in overtime and found the net there.
Big game, all game sevens are big ones, and you know, even though they score 40 seconds in, I felt like we stuck to our game for three and a half periods until we finally got that winner, and that was good to see. We played to win all the way till the end, and you know, the hockey gods got it right by giving us the big win here.
You know, obviously it's really sad, and you know, some of those guys, you don't know if you're gonna play with them ever again, obviously. So you know, it's a really tough pill to swallow. We have such a good group of guys in there and such a, you know, great coaching staff and management and everything. You know, it's just it's a great place to be, and you know, it feels like a family in there. And obviously with, you know, the amount of turnover, in pro hockey and stuff, you know, it's bittersweet, obviously. You don't know, you know, who's going to be back and that type of stuff. So
you go into overtime with Jake, you know it's going to take a perfect shot to beat him, and it was a perfect shot. Johnny made a great shot right under the bar. You can't do anything about that. But Jake Ottinger, he's a franchise goalie, and the good news is he'll keep getting better. He's a young guy. This is his first run through the playoffs. He's going to gain from this experience, and the Dallas Stars are in good shape for a long time with Jake.
So it'll be the Battle of Alberta next. Also, the Battle of the Sunshine State, a rematch from last year's playoffs. And we'll preview all of the second round matchups after this. Well, the second round is finally set, and there will be a day off around the league on Monday, and then action will pick back up Tuesday with the Lightning and Panthers in the Battle of the Sunshine State, followed by the Blues and Avalanche in a Central Division showdown between two playoff perennials at this point. What do you think is going to be the biggest key to that Blues-Avalanche series?
I think goaltending is going to be one of the huge keys of that. We haven't quite nailed down where we're at with Darcy Kemper, but I expect to get that news soon. There is no days off at the NHL Network for all you fans that are
true.
Wondering.
We'll be here tomorrow, don't worry.
But Jordan Binnington, we know how he's playing, and he's been money since taking over the net. Pavili Huso came in and won the last three games of the series. Changes the dynamic of the look a little bit of the St. Louis Blues. Their decor was depleted in that series against the Minnesota Wild, but Binnington helped to hide a lot of that loss by moving the puck so well in the defensive zone. He is a third defenseman. And, of course, the depth for the St. Louis Blues. If there's an Achilles heel for Colorado, it's that they don't have as much depth in their lower end forwards. Think their bottom six. Well, guess what? The Blues, they have a ton of depth throughout their lineup. Nine different goal scorers with 20 or more as you take a look at some of them right here. That's pretty darn impressive, almost unheard of. The Blues played as well as they could the final three games of the series against the Minnesota Wild. We'll see if they can keep that going. While with Colorado, we're going to see if there's any rust. Had a nice little break here for a change. Hopefully, that's a chance for Darcy Kemper to get right in terms of the stick he took to the eye.
Yeah.
And for some of their players that missed a lot of time down the stretch to kind of be fresh going into this one. Guys like Landeskog, Kadri, the Avalanche are going to be beasts to play, though. There's no doubt about it. They are the favorites. They're going to be the favorites until they get knocked out, in my opinion, not just to win each series, but to win the Cup. We'll see how that plays out. I think St. Louis has a much better chance than people are giving them to win this series.
Okay.
I'm not talking about just competing to win. They've got that playoff pedigree. They know what it takes to win. They have a core that was magnificent in the opening series. O'Reilly, Tarasenko, Perron, all with five goals.
Right.
And they still got Colton Parayko-Dak there, who I love.
Yeah.
Justin Falk has played well. Nick Leddy will be healthy. Mm-hmm. This is going to be a great series.
Yeah, most of the guys you just mentioned were part of that Blues championship team just 3 years ago. So the core is still pretty much intact from that team. And like you said, that depth, they've got it in spades. Colorado, by the way, has yet to get out of the second round in the Nathan MacKinnon era. So I don't know. I picked this maybe to be their year that they finally get past that
you
second
round.
You and
a lot round. Of people.
Right. But I picked them to win the Cup for the last, like, three straight years. So I don't know. I clearly don't know anything about the Avalanche. But we'll see if they can finally live
star
up to the
power
hype.
Power galore with this
exactly.
team. We're going to see that in full display. We'll see if it's enough to win series, though. We know MacKinnon will be there. We know Landeskog. We know Rantanen. We know Makar. There is a lot to love about the Colorado Avalanche.
And there's a lot to love, too, about a team down in Florida. And I'm not just talking about the two-time defending cup champs that just knocked off the Toronto Maple Leafs. I'm also talking about the team that won the President's Trophy, the Florida Panthers. You can see each team with two wins in their regular season meetings. What do you expect in this one? It is a rematch of last year's first ever playoff meeting between these two Sunshine State teams. It only took the Lightning six games to beat the Florida Panthers, but this one was so entertaining from the drop of the puck on game one.
Yeah, it really was. And for the second series in a row, the Tampa Bay Lightning are going to face a very formidable foe. A team that dominated the regular season, had scoring galore on three lines, and I think learned a lot last year in their loss to the Tampa Bay Lightning in that opening round. Make no mistake, the Washington Capitals, a veteran team, gave them fits at times. But They're going to face a different opponent in the Tampa Bay Lightning this round, a team that knows how to win, a team that has great goaltending, a team that has a great decor, a team that has a lot of star forwards. This is going to be perhaps my favorite series in the second round. I can't wait till it starts. I think that Florida has all the elements they need to beat the champs, but I'm still going to make them the underdogs in this series.
Yeah.
You've got to take it away from Tampa, and until somebody does, they should continue to be that role.
Do you fall in the camp of people who think that Florida actually escaped with a series win against the Washington Capitals? Because they did not play their best. In fact, the Caps really frustrated them at times. Do you think that might have been a wake-up call, what they needed in order to compete with the likes of John Cooper and the Tampa Bay Lightning?
I think it was a good wake-up call for him. I didn't think it would be easy against Washington, to be honest with you. A veteran team that knows how to play. Peter Laviolette, a veteran coach, kind of changed the way Washington played in the regular season, tried to slow things down a little bit, clog up the center of the ice. There was no doubt to me it frustrated Florida at times. They weren't able to get up and go the way they like to.
Right.
And that to them was tough, but I think they learned a lot in that series as well. The Florida Panthers, they're newbies to all this. They hadn't won in so long, going back all the way to 1996. Well, guess what? They feel that their time is now, and they've got the players that should be able to get it done. But Tampa's not going to give it to them, that's for sure.
Okay, then we look at Wednesday's slate, and we've actually got the Rangers coming off their big Game 7 overtime win against Pittsburgh, going up against the Metro Division winning Hurricanes. You can see the Hurricanes took 3 of 4 regular season meetings, and I think an intriguing storyline here is when you look in goal, because we have the presumptive Vezina winner in net for the Rangers with Igor Shesterkin. And in net for the Hurricanes, without any real update on Freddie Anderson, we presume it will be the former Ranger, Antti Raanta, going up against them. So what have you made of his performance through round one?
Fantastic. He just looks like a guy. He said it after their last win over the Bruins, Game 7. We're just having fun out here, and he's enjoying it. And he looks like a player like that. And when you do that, you tend to play your best. Now, the Carolina Hurricanes, they're the most, and I don't mean this negatively, robotic team in the National Hockey League. They play the same way game in and game out. It doesn't matter what's happening. They put a lot of pressure on the forecheck. They throw all kinds of pucks at the nets, and they don't make a lot of mistakes. They are a difficult opponent. Just ask the Boston Bruins. Now, they didn't play as well on the road. That surprised me a little bit. But obviously, they won all 4 games at home, which is a good thing. And their star players were their star players. Svechnikov played well. Aho played well. I thought Vinny Trocheck really stepped up. Jacob Slavin, to me, was the best player in that first round for the Carolina Hurricanes. And him and the rest of that decor, they also are what I call very repeatable. You know what you're going to get for the Canes. Mm-hmm. If you don't bring your A game, you're not going to beat them. I think that's going to be the case in this series for the New York Rangers. They're going to have to continue to be resilient and show they have the type of moxie they showed in this first round against Pittsburgh, having to come down and win the last, being down and win the last 3 games.
Yeah, and being down in each of those 3 games too, right? The first team in NHL history to trail in 3 straight elimination games and then go on to win those 3 straight elimination games that had never been done before Sunday night. So when you look at this team, I mean, the fact that they are coming off such an emotional series win, do you think that bodes well for them heading into this matchup?
I do. I think they're coming off a really big high. It was great to see Igor Shesterkin get back to that level he had set for himself throughout the majority of the regular season. He will most likely win the Vezina Trophy. We'll find out in time. But he played like a Vezina winning trophy player by the time this Game 7 was over. I felt like he really kept the Rangers in this game when he had to. He made every key save, a lot of times multiple key saves, back to back to back. He was terrific. And then Artemi Panarin showed up in a big way in Game 7, scored the OT winner. Beautiful shot. There's a lot to like about the New York Rangers right now. They're a very young team that has already overachieved, in my opinion, really starting from Game 1. Now they find themselves in the second round, validates that great regular season they had. And they're looking to continue to learn and grow and get better. That's definitely going to happen for them in this series.
Absolutely. And then the final series of the second round of the Stanley Cup playoffs will be the aforementioned Battle of Alberta, Oilers, Flames. They split games in the regular season, and it will be the first playoff meeting in the Battle of Alberta since 1991. We're going to have to get an official list of the guys who were actually born then, because these are younger teams, right? And most of their players probably weren't born back in 1991. We know a lot of the stars, Leon Draisaitl, Connor McDavid, you go over the Flames, Johnny Hockey, they weren't born in 1991. But they've been around enough now to know what this means, north of the border especially. How do you sum it up for maybe casual fans or people who aren't as familiar with the Battle of Alberta? What is the history and why is this so meaningful?
The history is going back to the Smythe Division, quite frankly, when these teams used to face each other every year and have incredible battles. That's what it was born out of. Think of those early 1980s, mid-80s Oilers teams. Oilers, of course, winning four cups throughout their run at that time. And then Calgary also, under the guidance and leadership of Lanny McDonald, who really kind of was like a player coach, their captain. That's where the history is born out of. Now, these players, this group of players, they've taken it to another level. Both teams know what the Battle of Alberta is, having played just in regular season games. Mm-hmm. But now they're going to see a different level.
Oh, yeah.
What's going to need to happen for Edmonton to win, or let's start with Calgary to win? Calgary's going to need to find a way to shut down Connor McDavid, Mike Smith. It's going to have to play well. It's going to be a great series.
And you think Mike Smith has what it takes, right? He learned from round one. He's got
He knows both these teams well, having played for both of them.
Yes, okay. Well, both of those teams coming off thrilling seven-game series wins in their first round. We can't wait for round two that starts Tuesday. But before we totally close the book on round one, we're going to hand out some superlatives from the first round. Stay tuned when NHL Tonight continues. Now that the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs is complete and in the books, it's time to hand out some superlatives. So, who do you think was the best team, the most impressive team through the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs?
Wow, there's a lot of teams that were impressive, but the one that stood out above all the rest for me was the St. Louis Blues. They won game one in surprising fashion. They're playing not just the second team in the Central, but the second best record in the West, Minnesota Wild. They win game one, they lose game two and three, then they make a change at the goaltending position, and everything came together, even while they had injuries. They lost Krug, they lost Letty, they lost Scandella at times. Bortuzzo, didn't matter. Jordan Binnington came in, settled this group down, and the depth that we saw in the regular season really took off. And nine different scorers had 20-plus goals, and it all came to fruition as they won the last three games of the series in convincing fashion.
Yeah, three straight wins in the playoffs is really impressive, no matter who you're facing. I'm a little surprised that there's not a nod to the team that swept its opening round opponent, but I guess your argument is probably that National Predators weren't
opponent.
Exactly. They weren't the level of competition that the Minnesota Wild were to the St. Louis Blues. Either way, it's going to be the Colorado Avalanche against the St. Louis Blues in the second round. So we can't wait for that. Okay, moving on. Best player of the first round.
Oh, boy. Wow, there was a lot of great ones. But I'm going to go right to the guy that led the league in scoring, Connor McDavid. He did absolutely everything you could expect from a superstar, except play goal, maybe. They could have used him maybe on a couple of nights, and it wouldn't have been seven games. But he was physical, as you saw right there on Sean Durzi. And it means so much to your team when your star player comes out and sets the tone. And he did it in every way, shape, or form. Defensively, physicality, and of course, scoring, as you would expect. He was completely dominant, came up with a big goal and assist in game seven. He never quits, as we saw in that game. For anybody that watched that game, a lot of other players on LA might have quit. But not Connor McDavid. He just kept coming and coming and coming. For me, he was definitely that player.
14 points. Like you said, leads all skaters.
There, Crosby, Ovechkin.
Incredible.
A few other good players that have done that in the series.
I mean, just amazing. Only the four goals, sure, but multi-point performances in six
plus
of the 7 games.
Plus 10 in the series.
I mean, that's just incredible. And that's against a very good defensive LA Kings team that, again, pushed this very talented Oilers team to 7 games. I know the Kings lost. They're not going to be your team that you go with in terms of best team overall, but maybe did they make, like, the biggest leaps in terms of a team from last year into this year. I mean, they probably weren't even supposed to be in the Stanley Cup playoffs this year.
I'll say they were the best surprise for me. I didn't have the LA Kings making the playoffs this year. They did go out and make some big acquisitions in Deneau and Arvidsson, and that really changed their fortunes, notwithstanding the fact that Arvidsson wasn't healthy for the playoffs, but Deneau had a huge impact. Their young players, they came along nicely this year, but above all else, two things really stood out. Todd McClellan, and then, of course, Jonathan Quick.
Absolutely. He turned back the clock.
He did. He was fantastic.
Okay, yeah, the LA Kings using words like rebuild for the last several years, and now here they were, taking the Edmonton Oilers to a Game 7 and falling in the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. So I like that, that they are your surprise team of the first round. Who was 100%. Your biggest surprise from a player standpoint in the first round?
Oh, boy. So many good players here.
I think a guy in South Florida caught your attention.
Yes, I know. I just want to figure out how I'm going to say this. Carter Verhaeghe had a very nice season. He's won a Stanley Cup with the Tampa Bay Lightning. He, by far, was my biggest surprise player. Why? Because he came up with 5 points when the Florida Panthers needed it most in another one of their comebacks, which I didn't think we'd see as many by that team, quite frankly. Certainly not at the rate that they had them in the regular season. But, of course, they did that because they're a great team. But Carter Verhaeghe was a guy on that team that I didn't think would be the tip of the spear in the efforts. And, you know, take a look at right there at the playoff point leaders. 12 points.
Wow.
12. He went from 5 points to 10 points in one game with that 5-point effort.
Pretty good.
He did everything you could expect of him. It really, truly looked like a breakout year. I mean, he had 55 points. 4 points, roughly. Had a great regular season, but I didn't see a playoff like this from him. I thought it would be Huberto or maybe Barkov. Or maybe Sam Reinhart. I could keep going on other players I would have had ahead of him on the Florida Panthers, and yet you need someone to step up. He did it in a big way. He scored goals. He set up plays, and I mean set up plays, not second assists. He had a lot of primary assists. Above all else, he just did everything for them. Loved his game. We'll see if he can continue that in the second round against his cross-state neighbors, the Tampa Bay Lightning.
And former team.
Yes, his former team. That's going to be a great series.
Yeah, Carter Verhaeghe, of course, won the Stanley Cup championship in the first of back-to-back cup wins for the Tampa Bay Lightning. So that battle of the Sunshine State, buckle up. And I would not be surprised if Carter Verhaeghe brought his A-game each and every night. By the way, he scored the series-clinching goal in overtime in Game 6 against the Capitals. 3 of the 4 game-winning goals that the Panthers had were off his stick. I mean, this guy... what is his ceiling? I mean, sky's got to be the limit for him at this point.
You know, at 26 years old, I think he's just scratching it. And that happens occasionally for players. A lot of it has to do with opportunity. His journey has been a great one, though. When you see guys playing in lower leagues, East Coast League, things like that, and then make it to the NHL breakthrough, you're generally happy for him. We don't often see him go on and be stars. He looks to me like he's a guy that's got a real nice path forward to be a true star player in this league.
Okay, now... the hard one, because there were so many great moments, right? This is what we live for, the moments, the storylines that come out of the Stanley Cup playoffs. So in the first round, what was your favorite moment?
Yeah, there was one thing that really stood out to me above all else. We've been through pandemic, a lot of changes over the last couple of years, bubbles, you name it. But this year, the fan support that I saw around the league, particularly in the Canadian cities, where every game is not a 20,000 person affair, it's more like a 35, 40,000 person affair. That was great to see. Hockey's back. It's roaring. We're taking a look right here. Toronto, Tampa has a nice outdoor deal. The Calgary Flames, sea of red that they showed up with in Edmonton. Carolina had a little tailgating. You name it. Wherever you went, people were fired up about hockey. I'm fired up about the Oilers, as that gentleman is right there. Pittsburgh. A lot of surprises, but when it was all said and done, my most favorite moments were to see the fans come out, enjoy the game, root for their team, and doing it in a really I don't want to say peaceful, but a really fun manner.
Absolutely.
There was a lot of fun going on.
Yeah, you're right. It was a return to normalcy that we have needed so badly for the past couple of seasons. So I love that, too, to see those crowds. I'm sure they'll be back in full force for the second round. I think I'd have to go favorite moment just because, I mean, it happened on this incredible night. The overtime game winner at Madison Square Garden, only, you know, the third time, I think, in Rangers history that they've had something like that to clinch a series. So very exciting. Exciting. And the New York Rangers ahead of schedule, I think, advancing to the second round. But there's so many moments, so many storylines.
Yeah, we could do this for 20 minutes.
Yeah, we can't wait to see what the second round of the Stanley Cup playoffs holds. With that, we tie a bow on the first round. It's on to the next one. Thanks for joining us here to recap Sunday around the Stanley Cup playoffs. For Brian Lawton, I'm Jamie Hirsch. Here's the best from Sunday.
Justin Robinson!
It doesn't get any better than this at Madison Square Garden for a Game 7.
Tigers open! Score! Rodriguez moving in, he scores! Make a Sabanajad, ties it in three! Now Panarin, he shoots, he scores! He scores! Rangers win!
You can throw the cliches out the window. Game 7.
Score!
This place is going nuts!
The only way to beat Jake Oettinger tonight might be voodoo.